All right, good morning. Thank you so much for coming. I know it's early. I got the premiere slot. That's the way I'm thinking about it. It's kicking it off, first slot of the day. It's not the worst slot, it's the premiere. That's my mindset anyway. So welcome to Why Cyber Training is Key and How to Do It Right. Before I get right into it, I want to play a little video. It was something that I was a part of recently I thought was a lot of fun.
The look on David Leonard's face is telling.
I had no idea that it was that easy to access information, particularly financial information.
For our story, Leonard agreed to let someone who knows how to hack try to gain access to his computer. Jared DeMott now owns the security consulting business VDA Labs in Kent County. He used to work for the National Security Agency, the NSA. He gained access to Leonard's web camera, capturing this video of him working on his computer. He also found his tax return with social security number and financial information.
Don't click on any links that you don't recognize.
DeMott used me to bait Leonard without me knowing. He set up an email that looked like mine with my name, Kirk Mason, and WWMT's letters. He then sent this link that Leonard thought was from me. DeMott gained access to Leonard's computer when he claimed Leonard had to click on this link to gain access to some information.
Why would I send it to you? Why wouldn't I, if I had data to show you, why wouldn't I just paste that into an email or whatever? So kind of thinking through what the person is sending you and like, does this make sense?
Most times a hacker would need you to click on something to gain access to your computer. DeMott says newer computers and always updating to the latest software offer better protection, but he says the most important thing is not clicking on links or opening suspicious attachments.
A lot of people feel like if I have, pick a vendor name and a virus program installed on my computer, then I'm safe. It doesn't matter. None of those, typically the majority of those, don't stop any of the attacks I did.
If hackers know your name and your hometown, it's very likely they can find your phone number and email address. Check out these texts Jared DeMott sent to David Leonard's phone, claiming to be from WWMT. Hey David, it's Tom, Kirk's assistant from WWMT News. He wanted me to let you know to check your email tonight, if at all possible. The text came from an unused 269 area code number, not from WWMT.
He was able to see what I was doing when I was working on my computer. This morning I had a visual picture of me sitting at the computer. So that was an eye-opener.
You talked about you can't really totally protect yourself.
Yeah.
Can you do it well enough where you should be able to sleep at night?
Okay, so that was a lot of fun. I had a local reporter that asked me to hack him and hack a volunteer, and it was pretty straightforward. Hacking the reporter was super easy because he's one of these folks that Facebook lives himself, like before he's gonna go on the air, he's like, hey, I'm about to go on the news, and like I could see he had Windows 7 and Office 2010. Like I could tell what his technology stack was just by looking at his Facebook page. So figuring out how to craft an attack and sending him the right malicious Office document with macros and stuff was super straightforward. And he has a very predictable schedule, right? He's on the early morning news from 4 to 7, then he checks his email at 7:15 or whatever. So I knew exactly when he would check his email, and very simple. The volunteer, that person was actually a little bit harder to hack because they're retired. They don't use their computer all the time. It turns out to be able to hack somebody's computer, I need them to at least use their computer or turn it on. It needs to be on at least for me to do something to it. So that's why I did the SMS spoofing where I was like, hey, you need to check your email. I kind of had to prompt him to turn his computer on. So I did a number of caller ID and SMS spoofing as part of the phishing attack, as well as I needed to figure out his stack, right? Because being a home user, I don't know when they check their email. I don't know what kind of computer they have. They might have a Mac, they might have a Windows. So there's different, and all, even though exploitation is pretty straightforward, and if you're good at it, you can definitely do it, all the attacks are usually like they only work for a specific stack or something like that. So I needed to make sure I got him the right attack. So I had set up a link that he clicked on first to fingerprint his browser and figured out he had Windows 10 with Edge and all this stuff. And I was able to get him the right links after I kind of prompted him to turn on his computer through a fake text purportedly coming from an area code that he trusted. It was that area code, that 269 was his area code, not mine. So that didn't come from my phone. I was able to send that to him in a way that looked believable. He knew he was going to be part of a story, but he didn't think his computer was hackable. He was one of these people that was like, well, if I don't give out my password, there's no way somebody can hack my password or my computer. So he was happy to be part of the story because he didn't think it was going to work. And the look on his face when we showed up with a reporter to like tell him and show him like the video himself and all his like financial data I'd stolen off his computer, all this stuff, was just like the color just kind of drains out of his face. It was really fun to be part of. So, and it's really interesting too, as kind of a pen tester and ethical hacker, and you know, more normally, right, I do this for businesses, right, who, you know, so I've never actually hacked an individual before because it's against the law, but he had signed stuff that said that it was okay, and so it was all on the up and up. So it was really a unique opportunity to be part of something like that, and it was definitely a lot of fun. So the part of the reason I wanted to play that before this talk is just to show you that there's still so much misunderstanding about what this whole cyber thing is and what security entails and what the differences are. I think there's, you know, still a whole generation of people that don't understand the differences between like a physical breach where somebody were to break in your house and steal your whatever, right, your TV or your jewelry or something, how that's different from a cyber attack and how much more scalable a cyber attack is. For example, I can attack you from a different country and I can attack 1,000 people at once. Like that whole like distance and space and scalability, you know, something about cybercrime is really quite different than physical, and the forensic science hasn't really caught up to that quite yet. Certainly there is incident response, that's part, you know, my company, we do some of that as well, but it's not something that is, doesn't have 100 years of history behind it, like fingerprinting and DNA and all the physical stuff. So there's still a lot of need, and I spend a lot of my time training and being trained. Some good folks and friends of mine, a person from Pluralsight up here, so I've made some classes for Pluralsight, Megan's here. Dr. Enbody here, he was my advisor actually for my PhD, so I've been through the training of all different kinds, whether it's in-person classes or online or on-the-job training, and so I've spent a fair bit of my career giving that back to doing trainings and doing stuff. So training is something that I'm really passionate about and have a real heart for. And it's something that is pressing in our time too, right? Our new president, whether you like him or not, just put out this executive order saying we need to review the nation's cyber vulnerabilities, and we need to review if people are being properly trained to work in cyber, which I actually thought was a pretty good executive order. I actually read it, it's very short, it's only a couple pages, and it basically says, hey, we need to see what's going on in cyber across America and do better, which I agree with, frankly. So I didn't have any beef at all with that executive order. But how are they going to do that? Whoever does that review and looks at, you know, whether people are being trained well, what are they going to look for? And how? Because it's not a simple problem, right? Security is like crime or sin or something, right? It's been around for a long time, and there's no solution to it, right? There's only, are you moving the ball forward, right? Are things getting better or worse? There is no, like, we're done with security, now we can move on with life. It just doesn't work that way. So how are they going to assess that? And this is something that the military's been thinking a lot about. I have a good friend of mine who's a colonel at West Point, and I've talked to him about this, and so they're always, you know, working on how do we grow our kind of cyber workforce. And I actually, in some ways, their approach is pretty good because they take the build versus buy approach, right? They can't go out and buy, you know, 100 people at $150,000 a piece, you know, like maybe a commercial business or something could. So they have to build these young people into cyber experts, which I actually think is the better approach. I think you get more value out of building young people and teaching them and training them. All across the board. I'm a big fan of building versus buying, actually. But industry has recognized the same thing that the military has, that there's a lot of threats and there's not enough professionals. And I think that's universally understood. Some of the numbers, if you look at different papers and reports, and some will say there's, you know, there's hundreds of thousands of job gaps, and some will say less. But most will say that there is a gap between the amount of cyber workers and the work to be done. And there are some papers, if you just Google for resolving cybersecurity workforce shortage or whatever, you'll find different documents that different individuals have put out there. And some of them are good and some of them aren't so good. But I would encourage you to go and check those out. And this is actually a tool that Megan suggested I put into my talk. I always, whenever I'm going to do a talk, a lot of times I'll reach out and ask people I know and trust if they have any ideas. This CyberSeek tool is something that I thought was pretty neat. It's sort of a heat map of which states have approximately how many jobs open, which is kind of neat to help try to close this cybersecurity talent gap. It also has some data on if you want to start as an IT auditor and you eventually want to become a cybersecurity consultant or whatever. So it kind of has sort of track-based data in it and how much you might expect to make and what are the types of educational things that are being requested in terms of whether it's a bachelor's degree or graduate degree, what types of certificates might be being requested for that position, what type of skills are being requested for that position. So there's a lot of good data, and I actually still feel like there's a lot of room to innovate here. So even though this is a great start, I think that there's room to innovate even more and get even more granular, something like a Zillow app, right? Where you look in your neighborhood, I'm in Grand Rapids, Michigan, what are all the jobs 20 miles from my house? How much do they pay? What do they need? Like even more granular than just by state, right? So I think there's a lot of room for somebody to take this idea and continue to innovate on that because this gap is so important. This is the most pressing field. We don't see this in every field, right? Not every field has some sort of, you know, site generate or, you know, sort of dedicated to trying to fill a workforce shortage. So it's kind of a neat opportunity to fill that particular role. But what are we really trying to learn? So that gives kind of a high level, and it's a little bit, you know, if you're a technologist or real down in the weeds engineer, it's a little high level, right? What are we on a little bit more lower level? What are we talking about in terms of what are some of the skills we want to fill and how should people be training for those? So secure software engineering is a big one, right? So static analysis, dynamic analysis, manual analysis, CI, all the things is a word I hear. Continuous integration, basically. How do we build testing and security into what we're doing so that every time we push and test, security is part of the code in the app that we just did? And that's new. That whole CI, all the things is just within the last few years. And so I've been in this field 17 years, and that gives you a sense for just how fast this field is moving. That's the other things that makes it really hard to train a workforce, because you can't put people like, we're gonna send people to 4 years of college and then a 2-year internship, and then in 6 years they'll be ready. Well, in 6 years the field's different than it was 6 years ago, right? And that's the problem. It's such a fast moving field. But still, you know, we can get those fundamentals in cryptography and user and data privacy, doing code auditing. Those are all part of the whole dev security. And what's interesting about that, I've got to just talk about this one more second, is that one of the things that makes security as hard is you basically need to be at the tip of the pyramid, sort of skill set wise, right? So if you're going to go in and teach developers about how to audit their code and secure their code, you essentially have to have a skill set equal to or better than theirs. And that's a tall order, because a lot of developers are really good at what they do, right? So to go in and be an expert and have developers want to trust you and listen to you and respect you, you have to have sort of the tip of the pyramid skill set, and that's tough. That's not something that is easy to acquire, basically. So we see the similar sorts of things on the enterprise, although one of the things that I like about the enterprise, I think there's a lot more opportunity to bring fresh people into the field. So particularly in the SOC, the Security Operations Center, is where a security analyst, somebody who's looking at alarms that come from your SIM tool, your Alien Vault, whatever you have, they can look at those and they can decide if they look important or not and escalate it maybe to a level 2 incident responder if it does look like a real breach has occurred or something. So I feel like in the SOC there's a real opportunity to either bring people maybe that didn't want to do college, you know, maybe they only want, you know, sort of an 8-month certificate or something, or maybe you've got somebody that he or she's been in the field for 30 years as a whatever, mathematician, accountant, and they just, you know, they've been downsized out of a job. And so they're very smart, hardworking individuals, but they're just not necessarily cyber people. They could retrain into a position like a SOC analyst pretty quickly, I think. So I think there's a lot of opportunity to kind of build a custom workforce. If you're a big company and you need 50 SOC analysts or whatever, you could set up your own 6-month, 8-month, whatever program to build these people in-house. And I think there's the need for that, because there's such a shortage gap that we can't wait 6 years for another whole batch of new, you know, cyber blood to come into the workforce. We need people now. So I think there's a big opportunity there. And of course, there's more of the level 2, level 3 type, you know, skill sets needed in the enterprise as well, like pen testing. That's kind of what the video I just played at the beginning, that's essentially what a pen tester would do, right? Learn how to social engineer somebody, phish somebody, put an exploit together, compromise their key data, that whole thing. To find vulnerabilities, misconfigurations, all of that good stuff. And of course, incident responders, malware analysis, you know, now you're getting in kind of a deeper skill set, right? Because they probably need to know a lot about software and how it's built and compiled so that they can reverse it and understand what the badness is doing. So you're back to that. Unfortunately, you're back to that tip of the pyramid. You need highly skilled people to do that. Same thing with security research. There's some opportunity, I think, for new folks to get into security research if they just have an interest in maybe, you know, web stuff, you know, cross-site scripting, SQL injection, whatever, or some DOS stuff, or just running tools at scale or whatever. But if you really want to go deep, you know, you really want to, you know, get into auto hacking or something and figure out what the vulnerabilities are within a vehicle and how they work and how to fix them and how to teach these automakers how to better architect a solution, you're back to the tip of the spear again, right? Because you have to essentially have a skill set equal to or better than the embedded engineers who wrote that whole system. And that's a tall order, once again. We see that same thing in data science as well, right? So at the intersection of math and statistics, machine learning, hacking skills, and expertise, you have data science. And you see a lot of new security startups wanting to use AI and machine learning and all this stuff to be able to quote unquote machine all the things. It's, in other words, the things that we might have done manually, like, is this threat a real threat? Is this alarm a real alarm? Is this binary suspicious or not? Is it, you know, malware? Is it okay? Is it benign? How can we build a neural net that can decide the vast majority of that at scale that a human never could, and maybe only escalate, you know, a small percentage of that to this? There's still always going to be a need, I think, for the skilled human to be involved in that process somewhere. But again, it's kind of a tip of the spear. So one of the things I did as part of this research, I wanted to talk to other people, other experts in the field, and ask them, what's your thought on training? What's the best way to train people in cyber as far as what you think? And so I reached out to a number of people. One of them was Chris Eagle. He wrote the IDAPRO reverse engineering book, and he's a professor at the Naval Postgraduate School. And he's, of course, you know, because he works in formal education, he's a big fan of education over training, and it's not surprising that he feels that way. Because basically he feels like if you're getting these, you know, certs, you know, you're kind of cramming for the CISSP or whatever it might be, it's very much a cram mindset. It's very much a prescriptive, like you do this, 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 and this is how you like solve this problem. And so you can create people that are pretty good at solving a problem, but now if things change in a year and you ask them to solve a totally different problem, they don't have that foundational educational base to be creative in the way that they approach problems. And so he's a huge fan of formal education. And I think I am too. And I think most people would agree with that. That is, you know, ideal, right? If you want to build these tip of the spear experts, they do probably need some level of formal education. The only problem is it's expensive, mostly in terms of time, right? It takes years and years to create these folks, just like college always has. So it's a kind of a hard problem. Like, we need them now, but the best way to get them is to wait. And, you know, it is what it is. So I've asked a number of different folks from different backgrounds too. I asked Katie what she thought, and one of the things that she wanted me to express is that she felt like, as a woman in security, she had been, faced some adversity in the workforce. As in cyber, she feels like it's kind of a white male's game, so she feels like there's not so much of a pipeline issue. A lot of people are talking about the pipeline right now, where there's not enough girls interested in security, so we need to get them interested at a young age. She felt like that wasn't the case. There are girls that are interested. They just face headwinds early on, and so they decide to go into something else. That was kind of her approach. So she didn't do college, or she did, but not cyber. She did a different degree, and so she felt like she would have made it with or without college, because she feels like passion beats education, basically. If you're super passionate about a subject, you'll find a way to get to it and get it done and understand it, whether or not you have formal education, which I can totally agree with that. I think passion does. If you're super passionate about anything, you'll find a way to make it happen. So I would agree with that. She also wanted to point out that cyber is not just a highly technical thing, right? It's not just trying to reverse a malware or whatever, where you need this highly technical skill set. It's also, we need people in Congress, we need public servants, we need people with a law background, with an accounting background, with all these different backgrounds. There's a lot of opportunity for those people to also get in cyber, because there's so much going on right now in cyber policy and cyber law and all of these different domains that really affect a larger portion of the population, rather than just the highly technical skill sets. When you talk about balancing security versus privacy, that's a big debate of our time, right? Whether you like Snowden or not, that's one of the things that helped come from what he did when he stole the information and left the country or whatever. Basically, he brought this idea that we should have a public conversation about there is a trade-off between security and privacy, and what's the right level of both. You need both, and you want both, so how do we get both? I've talked to a young peer of mine, Nathaniel, and he felt like education failed him. He dropped out of college. He didn't think, he wasn't good at math, and he was always told that if you wanted to go into computer science or hacking, you needed to be good at math. And he wasn't good at math, so he didn't think he could do it, and so he was hanging out at one of these hacker spaces where you can go and just like hang out, sort of. He wanted to like look into 3D printing or whatever, and he got talking to people about programming. And long story short, he ends up as an F-sharp functional programmer at my prior place where I was working. And he's pretty good at it. And he feels like, actually, to him, he feels like programming is more like English, more like writing a poem or more like a foreign, learning a foreign language. He feels like being good at English, and that was something he was always good at, has helped him a lot as a programmer, but he was never told that that was a useful asset. Like, basically, you being good at English is not going to help you in computer science. But it turns out, at least according to him, it did help him a lot, and he's been successful as a programmer. So one of the reasons I wanted to do this, to bring all these personal stories together, is to show you there's so many different paths into the field. Whether you have college or don't have college, whether you're good at math or you're not good at math, whether you're male or female or whatever, it doesn't matter. There's a place for everybody in the field as far as I can tell. I've talked to a lot of people from various backgrounds, and I've seen a lot of success on all sides. I talked to Colonel Babbitt. He's the fellow I know at West Point. Very smart individual that's worked hard his whole career in the Army. And he's a big fan, just like Chris Eagle, of traditional education, building them up, giving them that foundation. But one of the challenges they have, and I think every company has, is they invest all this money and time into their cadets. They train them for 4 years, and they send them to all the best SANS trainings and stuff once they're out of, you know, West Point and all this stuff, and then they leave. And they go get a job that pays better in industry, right? It happens, like, you know, every time, basically. And they really struggle with that. They really struggle with retention. How do they hang on to folks that they've invested so much into? I don't know. That's a hard problem because, you know, it definitely does happen. So that retention is something that the whole field faces, right? How do you keep people interested? It's not just money, but how do you keep them interested in the work and engaged and excited about what they're doing? Another person I asked his opinion of was a guy named Stephen Ridley. He's a security researcher in the field that runs his own business, and he's been pretty successful in cyber. They do a lot of Internet of Things, security embedded, reversing, exploiting, and make a product, I think, to do stuff with the IoT. I don't even know exactly what all his company does, but I wanted his opinion. And he feels like a quality traditional education is the way to go, particularly something more like computer science. So there are a lot of bachelor's degrees now that you can find at universities that specialize in, like, information security or kind of like a niche, like a cyber bachelor degree or whatever, but they tend to be very trade focused, right? Like, you're gonna learn to configure a Cisco firewall as part of that degree or something, and it's more like, you know, you're getting kind of more of a trade school, which is not bad. You'll definitely get a job with that, but it doesn't, again, give you kind of that educational base that a traditional computer science degree or something might give you. And he also felt like there's a lot of opportunity for maybe, you know, a mathematician who got downsized out of another field or something to come into cyber and be a very productive part of the workforce because they have that traditional education and background. They do have a solid base to work from. One of the things that was interesting talking to Stephen, though, not to kind of step in it, right, because I didn't intend to make this part of my talk today. I was just going to talk about training. I wasn't going to talk about diversity or anything else. Because it just wasn't something I thought I was going to touch on. But a lot of the people I talked to kind of wanted to talk about that. So that became part of the talk today. And unlike some of his female counterparts that I talked to, he's not an affirmative action fan. He doesn't feel like you should force a certain amount of gender or race into a company because he feels like it has negative unintended consequences. He feels like everybody should be exposed to cyber at a young age in engineering and, you know, STEM and all the stuff. But if they choose to go into some other field, like, that's their choice. You shouldn't be pushing people into a company just to fill a quota. It just didn't make sense to him. So that was his opinion. That's not mine. And I thought that was interesting. That's not something I expected him to say, frankly. In talking to people, I got feedback that was always a little unexpected to me. You ask 10 people their opinion, you get 10 different answers is what happened to me. So I guess that kind of makes sense. I talked to Rebecca Harvey. She's another colleague of mine in the field. She runs a cybersecurity practice in Michigan. And she had the opposite effect of mindset. She feels like there is a place for affirmative action of forcing a certain amount of quotas because in her mind and in her experience, discrimination is more likely than, you know, artificially filling a role with unqualified candidates, basically. So she had kind of the opposite view there, you know? So it is what it is. And she's also, not surprisingly, wanted me to mention that she's a huge not fan of the booth babes, right? So where you put pretty girls at a cyber booth to try to draw guys in to look at the technology, whatever. She obviously doesn't like that. She thinks it's super degrading and super lame. So I would agree with her, by the way, on that. I've always thought so. Even years ago when it was a big thing at, like, Black Hat, you know, 10 years ago, you'd go and you'd see they'd hire, like, girls in leather and stuff. And to me, it was always a huge turnoff. It's like, I'm not going to go talk to that vendor just because they have that. So I would agree with her on that. She also agreed with other people in that a four-year degree followed by a two-year apprenticeship, so the six-year training window is essentially the ideal way to build a cyber candidate, and I would agree with that. And she sees a huge shortage of workers. I asked her if she was seeing a shortage of workers, and she said absolutely seeing a shortage of workers. They get asked all the time by her customer base, hey, we would love for you guys to give us, 10 people in cyber to help us run our cyber program. And she's like, we don't have 10 people to give you. Like, I'd like to send you 10 consultants, right? Because we'd make money on that. That'd be good for everybody, but we just don't have. We can't find 10 cyber consultants. So definitely a shortage of workers from her perspective. And the last person I asked was Josh Polly. He's a professor at DSU that I work with at DSU as well. And he really feels like, obviously getting that traditional base is good and everything like that, but hands-on, really hands-on for cyber is super important, because a lot of the skills that you're asked to do, whether it's reversing or looking at logs or pen testing, it's all very hands-on if you're going that route. Now, there are other routes in the field, right? There's more policy, there's more legal, there are other routes in the field that certainly are not hands-on, but if you're gonna try to become a pen tester or something like that, you really need a degree that gives you a lot of hands-on. And he felt like one of the things he's seen a lot in the field, and I've seen this too, when you go to a hacker con, the trainer or the speaker or whatever kind of has this, sort of like, I'm a cool hacker, look at me, like I'm the man sort of mindset and training style. And he feels like that training style is not helpful, it's not productive. It's usually like you're just kind of like supposed to be awed by the trainer or the speaker, but you're not really learning, you're not really getting any help when you're stuck in a lab, you're not getting the kind of one-on-one assistance that you would really like. So that was kind of the best and the worst as far as what he's seen in the field. And I would tend to agree with him on that. There, I have seen some of that best, really good teachers versus kind of more of the arrogant security researcher mindset types. So I would agree with him on that. So to summarize what some of the people said, let me see how I'm doing on time here. Okay, I'm good. College is a good bet. It definitely makes you more competitive, just like it always has. The whole point of education, and I think I actually heard this from Don when I was talking to him, is that education is essentially a shortcut to experience. So you can either have 5 years experience in the field or a college degree or whatever. They're essentially equivalent, especially in cyber. You don't really need it. I know people in cyber that don't have any college at all that are probably better and probably make more than I do, right? So it's not a field where you need a degree, but it is a good bet, particularly for things where you might want to go deeper. Like if you want to be a DBA, just database administrator, so like basically a tradecraft, you can go and get a cert, you can go and get skills, you can be a DBA. But if you want to work on database theory algorithms, you probably should have a computer science background, right? You really need that fundamentals and that theory and the computer science bits of it. Plus, there's a lot of other things that are great about college, like the whole idea that they'll give you a career track. So if you don't even know where to start, like I'd like to get into cyber, but I have no idea what classes I should even take, right? That's the whole point of college, right? They give you this whole track and build connections and maybe hook you up with an internship, and all of that's good. I will say that, I've met plenty of people that didn't have college and they made it work just fine. It is a little harder to get in at times. I've seen some people do very, very well in the field without any college. I've seen some struggle too. They struggled to break in, right? Because it's like they didn't have experience and they didn't have college. How do you break into a field with neither? Right now you're in kind of a tough spot. You can do it. Usually you need to start with an internship or kind of get in on the ground floor somewhere, and I've seen that work. That it's just harder if you don't have both. The best way to do cyber if you don't have college is to come in sideways, where you've been working for 10 years in another field or something, and you come in with a lot of weight and clout and experience, and it's like, well, I don't need a degree. I've been a senior IT admin for 10 years or whatever, right? And it's like, okay, fine, you're in. So that works really well. I talked a little bit about this need to not only have that long term, and this is kind of one of the takeaways from the talk, but also that short term. How do we get both? How do we fill the gaps of today and tomorrow? And I really think there needs to be more sort of apprenticeships, more short term, very targeted training programs where big companies or whatever have these ways to kind of build their own cyber workforce. I think they'll be more successful than trying to buy a cyber workforce. I think it's going to be really expensive and really hard for them to find 20 senior cyber consultants or whatever, right? So that's kind of, something that I've already talked about, basically. I'm a big fan of the sort of the build versus buy. There's a time and a place for both, but I think, being able to do that is good. So once you're in the field, once you've established yourself and you're kind of off and going, what are the best continuing education things in cyber? What kind of works, what doesn't? And there's really no right or wrong answer there. I mean, obviously, everybody knows that there's a lot of options for everybody. There's on-the-job training, there's mentoring, there's in-person trainings, there's video trainings, there's capture the flags, conferences like where we're at today, following people on blogs and Twitter, going to graduate school. All of those are good options. And I would essentially encourage you, if you really want to be, you know, kind of at the tip of the spear and really push the field hard, I would encourage you to essentially do all of those at some point, to whatever extent you can, right? Why not get involved in every one of those? And, you know, this on-the-job training, especially for developers, this true apprentice, you think of the craftsmen of the old, right? Like thousands of years ago, there were sayings where you literally ate the dust of the teacher or the master, right? If you were going to be a, you know, master carpenter or a Jewish rabbi or something 2,000 years ago, you literally followed them around and like ate their dust and like did whatever they did. If they, you know, went here, you went there. If they went to the bathroom at noon, you went to the bathroom. You literally did everything they did. You become kind of like their apprentice. We don't really have that, I guess, quite like that in society today, but I think especially for certain roles like developers and really all of this, pen testers, SOC analysts, I think that that's super useful. I think being able to work with somebody senior to yourself and have that apprenticeship where you can truly learn from an expert is invaluable and rare. It's hard to find, basically, but if you can find it, I would suggest you absolutely take it. The other thing you might pick up from that individual, if they're good at what they do, is they can probably teach you how to be in it for the long haul. I see, especially on the bleeding edge of cyber, like an exploit development where you're constantly like trying to find OODA and product and write an exploit. It's really hard because that's something that shouldn't be possible, right? If you're like trying to find OODA and Microsoft's Edge browser and like write a working exploit, like that's not supposed to work. That shouldn't be happening. Like, so they do everything they can to make that impossible. It's still generally possible, but it's really, really hard. And I see a lot of people who don't do that burn out. 3 years later, they need 2 years off, right? Because they push so hard that they're just done. They're burned out. So the other thing I think you could pick up from a mentor if they've been in the field 15, 20 years is, how do I keep myself healthy day in, day out? How do you keep your eyes healthy, your back healthy, your body healthy, your mind healthy? Like, it's a tough thing being a knowledge worker, right? Especially if you're pushing the ball hard. It's something that all of us in the field have probably struggled with at some point. So, as for graduate degree, I get asked occasionally, like, you know, should I go get my master's or my PhD? And I've had people ask me that, and they're kind of curious how it relates to certs, for example. Like, hey, I'm thinking about going to get my CEH or my CISSP versus going back to graduate school. Like, what's a better option in your opinion? I got my graduate degrees, and I liked it. I felt like, for me, it was a good bet. I feel like, for me, it's something that you can never take from me. You know, I have my PhD from Michigan State, and like, I can always say that, right? I'll always get to say that. Where if I have my CSSP and I forget to renew it next year, now I've like lost it and I have to go back and get it again. And like, I feel like certs kind of come and go more. So, you know, but I feel like they're both super valuable. You should probably do both if you can. Like, there's no reason not to, but it's not for everyone. For me, I liked it. For a lot of other people, they said, no, I don't need graduate school. It takes too long. It's too expensive. They don't really learn anything. The professors don't know what they're doing, blah, blah, blah. I'd rather go and get the certs. That's fine. That's a good way to do it too. I don't think there's anything wrong with that at all. There's a million different certs out there. You can find one that fits your field. And I think it's particularly helpful if you're just breaking into a field. Like, if you're sort of new and you need to establish credibility with the customer and show them that you have your CISSP or whatever, I think it can be super valuable. If you've already got credentials, I don't know that you necessarily need it. In-person trainings is something we see quite a bit in our field. I teach at Black Hat every year, and other conferences like that, DerbyCon and other places. You can go and get a 2-day class on whatever you want, malware analysis, exploit development, code auditing, you name it, you can find a class on it. They're more expensive than other options, but they're a lot shorter term, and they're really good for essentially working professionals, people who are already in the field, people who have a corporate budget to go and get training. People who want to maybe meet like-minded peers, maybe meet the instructor, kind of get that one-on-one time. A lot of companies will actually use it as a chance to kind of get the gang together, too. I see a lot of, like, companies that have a security research division. They may be scattered all over the world, right? You might have, you know, a person in Germany, somebody in Israel, somebody in Asia, wherever. And you've got 10 people on your team, and you manage them all from your home in Arkansas or something like that. How do you, twice a year or whatever, get your folks together? Maybe you bring a trainer and you bring them in for a week, and as part of that, there's a 2-day training somewhere in the middle or something. Use it as kind of part of the whole team building experience. I've seen that be very successful. And there's a lot of online training. That's something that I've more recently gotten involved in with Pluralsight, and there's probably certainly others, companies like that out there with the whole crowdsourcing training model of basically we're going to get all the experts, get a little bit from each one of them, and deliver it to the customers, and you pay a much smaller fee, a monthly fee, compared to in-person trainings, and I think that can be very successful. I think we'll see a lot more of that in the future. I think that that type of education scales so much better. It's cheaper, and you can reach everybody basically with that kind of training, where the other training is not for everybody essentially. So I'm a big fan of that. I'm also a big fan of CTFs, and it's something that's kind of unique to cyber, the Capture the Flag challenges. And that's where basically you're competing against either other teams or maybe just against yourself. They could be Jeopardy-style challenges where you have to try to be the first to solve, you know, reversing for 300 or whatever compared to your counterparts or whatever. Or it could be more kind of team-on-team where you're all trying to attack each other and steal tokens and submit it to a scoring server to see who ends up with the most tokens or points at the end of the game. There's lots of different games. But one of the things that's really unique about cyber is basically it's us against them. It's a very sort of like adversarial mindset. And I don't know, maybe that's part of the reason why the field is, you know, demographically the way it is or something, I'm not sure. But it is kind of unique to cyber, I would say, that whole like it's a battle out there. The bad guys are trying to break in and we've got to keep them out. That sort of mindset, that's kind of unique to cyber. There's not a lot of other fields where you kind of day in, day out have that mindset, right? If you're, I don't pick some other profession, you probably don't think like that. I sometimes try to explain what I do to like family and friends that do something totally different. They're like an interior designer or whatever, a flight attendant, I don't know, whatever they do for their job, and they're like, just kind of look at me like, that sounds really weird. You're like, keep bad guys out. And it just sounds kind of strange. So it's just, it is kind of a different sort of field. And one of the things that's great about CTFs is that the whole like hacker skills, the hardcore stuff you get during those kind of challenges, you're forced to compress your skill set into like a weekend and really work hard, and they're probably terrible for your body because you sit for like 48 hours. But it is a way that you can kind of push the ball hard. Conferences are pretty big in probably a lot of industries. I think a lot of industries have trade shows and expos and everything, but they're very big in security, as you know. You guys are here, so I don't have to tell you about the benefits of networking and following leaders in the field and learning about new tools and products. All that whole thing is a big thing in cyber and something I would recommend. Twitter is a big thing in security that's kind of unique. Twitter's not a big thing in every other field. A lot of other individuals are more using, obviously, you know, maybe Snapchat or Instagram or Facebook or other types of social media. But Twitter is definitely probably bigger in cyber than other ones. So finding some people to follow and figuring out what they're talking about and getting involved in the conversation on Twitter might be a good bet, maybe not. Not everybody likes to do it. It's kind of a waste of time probably at times, like all social media, but it does kind of keep you seeing what at least people are talking about, and it helps bring a global community together. If you see a bunch of people on Twitter talking about what's going on at RSA, you don't have to be there personally. You might be sitting in your apartment in France or something, and you can go, oh, there's a big conference going on in San Francisco right now. That's cool. Like, you kind of have some idea what's going on in cyber. Okay, so to summarize, you know, some things can't be fully rushed. We probably don't want neurosurgeons who have only done, you know, a two-week class online or something like that, right? So we can't fully rush this whole cyber training thing. But I do think, even having said that, there is a place for everybody. Everybody both in diversity, everybody both at skill set, everybody both in their passion, whether they're more technical or more policy. I think there's a place for everybody to plug in, so I would encourage you to encourage other people to plug in, because it's such a great field, such a growing field that I think a lot of people that don't know about it, there's, you know, it's a shame when I meet a smart person that doesn't have a job and it's like, well, there's so many jobs in cyber right now. You should totally look at transitioning into that. So right away, find somebody to follow on social media if you want. Maybe try taking an online class. There's a lot of places where you can try that for a limited time. Like at Pluralsight, I think you can try it for free for a month or something. So I would encourage you to give it a whirl. And also, go a little deeper. Try an in-person training. Attend a conference. Compete in one of these Capture the Flags. Even if you think you'll be terrible at it, it's all right. Get some friends together and give it a whirl. And even if it doesn't go well, you'll learn something throughout the process. And also, think about, are there ways that you can give back? Because somebody helped you at some point in your career. If you've made it to any extent in your career, if you're a senior cyber whatever, with a master's degree or something, somewhere along the line, somebody helped you get to that. You didn't get to that all on your own, despite your ego and whatever you might think about yourself, right? Somebody helped you, and you should consider trying to give some of that back to the community in some other way. So That's all I have. Any questions? I don't know if, do I have time for questions? I have four. Yeah, go ahead. You want to use a microphone or you want to shout it out? Okay.
So, in addition to things like stance training, you know, which is very expensive, there's CIS training. Are there other certificates or programs that you'd recommend for people, you know, at entry levels all the way through senior levels?
That aren't expensive?
Yeah.
Well, now you've hit the crux of it. No, unfortunately, that's part of the thing that I see in cyber. There's no necessarily no simple solution. A lot of those certs do cost money and take time, some less than others. Some of them you could probably do more online or, you know, get involved in various ways, but they definitely take an investment for sure. Yeah, no problem. Sorry. I wish there was an easier answer. Any other questions? All right. Well, thank you very much.